Greetings, sir and sirettes, and welcome back to From the Depths with me, Lathrix. And of course, welcome to the creative mode, in which today we are going to be doing something a little bit different, rather than what I was meant to be doing today, which of course was to add a new defensive structure in the form of a missile silo, possibly two of them. We are instead going to be building a submarine. Now, it's been so long since I've made one of these, it would be insanity to try and build it in the campaign because I wouldn't be able to test it correctly, and there would be no chance that I would be able to build it in time for the next few battles. So, reluctantly, here we are in the test mode in which we can make our second vehicle of the season, and honestly, our first vehicle completely for combat. Now, some of you will hate me, some of you will love me, but we are likely going to be going down the route of missiles, because missile submarines are by far the easiest to set up, and it will give us a chance to go a little bit silly with very, very oversized missiles. Rather than going for the standard size missiles anywhere between 4 and 7, I intend to go 10 plus, so it's going to be a few drastically powerful missiles at very, very long ranges, enabling the sub to avoid the enemies as much as possible. And honestly, although this will be very cheesy, it will be a very effective craft. It also means that because we have the missiles set up, we can very easily set up a control block system so that we can use, if we go over here, the missile boy radars. Radars, rather. Radar sounds so much cooler now, but these will essentially allow us to drop the radars on the top of the water from the missile launchers, enabling us to actually see the enemies, which is very, very helpful indeed. This also means we don't have to go down the route of a lot of detection systems, because all the missiles need is to know that the enemy is actually there. As soon as they know that, they can just do their business. I will also most likely be adding torpedoes, which will only fire at enemies which the sonar detects, which are actually in the water, making this a very, very nasty craft. It will most likely be steam-powered and will have minor to medium armor. It's going to be more about being able to go quite low under the water, be able to avoid enemy detection, and to have a nasty burst at the start of the game. So, let's just make a nice simple shape to begin with, and then we'll get started. Actually, what I may do is have a point of symmetry between two blocks. This way, we could have a seriously pointed nose, which would enable us to look really, really cool. So I think that's what we'll do. We'll put the symmetry in between these two blocks, and that's where we shall start the building from. I don't want this to be too big, but if we get to around about 2,000 volume, I think I will be quite happy. Is this in the correct place? No, it's not. It's quite hard to tell when you only have so few blocks, because the mirror line is very, very small. There we are. Okay, back to building, and I'll be right back once we have the front section completed, and if I can actually remember how to make a submarine controllable. I don't really know what I'm doing right now, but I think this will work out for the best. So we're going to have essentially two sets of fins, one on the top, one on the bottom. This will massively increase the surface area of the sub to enable very, very sharp controls. But also, it may end up looking somewhat like a sunfish, just like an Ivorian, which will make me very happy as well. Just a nice little side effect. We are currently on 100, well, almost 100 of the volume limit, so we still have a very, very long way to go. So for this sub, we are going to use the power of hydrofoils to control our depth. Now, there are multiple ways of doing this, and I believe you can even build these on the inside, but I sort of like how they look on the outside, so we're going to do this, and what we're going to do is, as we build, try to balance these as much as possible, so that when it tries to go up, it won't cause pitching either way, and when it goes down, it does the same. It just literally floats it upwards and downwards in the water, as long as the ship is moving, as long as the sub actually has some momentum. I think this will turn out pretty good, honestly. It should be fairly stable, it should be fairly easy to create from here, if I'm doing everything correctly, which I might not be, but we'll just have to wait and see. I have no idea what I'm currently doing, so it sort of looks like a proper fish now. Wasn't actually my intention, but after zooming out, yep, we've made a fish. Because why not? Let's call it the Red Snapper, or something similar to that for now, and let's carry on. There's still a lot I need to do, considering right now it's just mostly the armored shell, and absolutely nothing else. There will definitely be enough space, however, for the ammunition, for the steam boiler room, and of course for all of the propulsion elements. It's just going to be a bit weird with this type of very asymmetric shape. So I've decided not to go with the fish look, because although it was kind of hilarious, it looked terrible. I'm also thinking I will change the colour scheme from this glaring red to possibly a more brownish red, or possibly a blue or green to go with the main darker colour of the regular metal. The overall shape is now coming along nicely, although I do sort of get a feeling that this looks a little bit more like a spaceship than a submarine. In fact, we could easily see this as even a thruster craft, but overall I am still pretty happy with it. We still have a lot to do on the outside in terms of looks, and then we can start working on the inside. I need to add the pitch control first so that I can test out some things such as the minimum depth we can go to while still firing the missiles, or the lowest depth, I should say, while still being able to fire the missiles, in addition to other things like that. And to do those tests, I do at least need the ship to be able to keep itself perfectly straight. At the moment, as we can see, it does rock around far, far too much, so steam engines and pitch controls after I sort out the back section here. What I'm thinking is that all of the forward thrust will come from this section here, and then all of the turning capabilities, I'm going to bring this in a little bit, make it into a sort of cove, and then have all of the propellers on here and on here, and then a couple I could easily squeeze here and here on this straight section at the front, and maybe even a couple in here for the greatest effect. That way we can move very quickly away from things trying to get close to us. This will be a very, very long range vehicle, and we don't want to see any enemies within maybe 1,500 meters. Okay, I've just added two very small steam engines, and I'm surprised by just how much armor this thing has ended up having. Because I've built this from the inside out, constantly adding layers, there is a grand total of 6 layers from each side until we get into the core. The core itself, of course, will have the AI, the engines, and the weapon systems, meaning that this is actually going to be pretty hard to kill. It seems like no matter what I try to build, I end up building it tanky. It's just in my nature. So now we have the engines, we can get to work sorting out the pitch controls, which will be controlled by the automated control blocks and the ever glorious, where are you, dedicated Heliblade spinners. So I'm going to add one in the front and one in the back, and that is of course the dedicated Heliblade spinner, but also I'm going to add 2 sets of the automatic control blocks. This way we have a lot of redundancy. If we lose the front of the craft, it should be okay. If we lose the back of the craft, it should be okay. Pitch is incredibly important if we don't want to be completely helpless. Okay, that is actually a little bit too strong, even with only half of the stuff attached. Well, that's good. It means we'll have a lot of redundancy, and we are now rolling because I haven't added the anti-roll stuff, but at least the pitch stuff is working. The problem is, we've made this so thin, it's going to be so, so vulnerable to rolling over, it will be ridiculous. We have essentially made the space rocket in the water. It's the water rocket, everyone, and that may be what I end up calling it. The problem is with the roll stuff, I can't really add that until we have a finalized center of mass, and that's nowhere near finished yet. So, let's add some armor to this back section, then we can add our second section for the pitch controls, then we will add the weapon systems, then we will add the roll controls, and then we're pretty much all good to go except for the AI. Okay, pitch is now completely working, both on the back and the front, and it sort of looks like a rave show. Everything's going perfectly for our little ocean-dwelling rocket. There go the basic movement systems, and let's just turn off those lines. Excellent. That is actually staying very stable, considering I haven't yet set the hydrofoils. Just having them present does stabilize the craft massively. Pitch is doing fantastically. Of course, I still haven't added the roll system, since they are possibly the most finicky out of all of them. But okay, the sub is looking like it's going to function perfectly. And it's not even that slow. I was thinking it was going to be slower due to the lack of backwards-facing propellers, and of course the main thing, it's very, very heavy. We have accidentally added way too much armor to this thing. We could convert some of the armor into light alloy instead, which would make it far faster, but I feel like the extra armor, now it's here, is going to serve us much better. Okay, all going well. Ignoring me falling off, by the looks of things, it's now all working perfectly. It's rocking a lot right now because I haven't got the total mass of the craft completely added. Everything is a little bit too strong, so the pitch is far too overcompensating, and the same goes for the new roll Hellablade spinners, which means now this thing is perfectly stable. It won't roll over, it won't suddenly nosedive. The only thing it can't do currently is stay at a specific depth. It is technically very, very slowly sinking. And that is the next thing we have to fix. That's interesting. So, if we do have this hydrofoil system, we must disable reverse. At the moment, the hydrofoils are all set to sending the craft upwards, hence why we are essentially acting like an old school hovercraft and sort of floating along the water. Actually, we're more of a boat. At this stage, I could say I've just made a boat, with really inefficient placement of turbines. Or rotors. Or things. That is pretty cool. I do love the mechanical side of this game. When you see things like this all working together, it is rather glorious. Okay, back into the hull, and let's add the other half of those command blocks. So this one here is minus 20, let's put this one above that. Hydrofoil, set hydrofoil angle to minus 45, which is far too much, but right now all of our systems are far too powerful, because that's the easiest way to tweak it. Start with something far too powerful, and then scale it back until the craft looks a little bit better. In terms of actual functionality, going overboard with these tends to be a little bit better, since they balance themselves out against each other, and thus you can lose some of them and still remain effective. It just looks incredibly silly, which is a little bit too far for me. So maximum range, then activate when greater than input, and let's say minus 20. Of course, I need to put the 2 in first. There we go. So what should happen now is that when this hits the water, it should be forced downwards until it gets to minus 20. There we go. There's all the lines I wanted to see. Hitting minus 20, and it is stabilizing at around about minus 17. Now, the reason this is happening is because this altitude is going more off the medium of the ship. The control blocks, on the other hand, are looking at where they are in regards to the ship, and they are nowhere near the middle. Also, we have stopped right now because I've gave it no orders. Move over there. I need to make sure you can still work. Okay, it looks silly. Oh, look at that rocking. Let's do that. Oh, wow. That is... It looks like it's trying to swim, but it has no fins. It's actually quite quick, though. A lot faster than I was expecting, but oh, dear lord, that is awful. Turning speed is good, and it is very stable, despite the fact it looks so silly. Like I was saying, this is because every single system, especially pitch, is really, really powerful for the size of this craft. But it is working, and it is staying at around about minus 17. Now, I will put this lower when it comes to the actual campaign, but in terms of testing, it's a lot easier if it's a bit closer to the surface. Okay, weapons next, I suppose.
Taking control.
Okay, that was sort of glorious. So those missiles are 8 long, which means they are incredibly expensive and will only be fired at the start of combat. Those are the burst damage missiles. And by the looks of things, they're working just as intended. They likely aren't too good though versus very fast moving targets. They're not the least agile missiles in the world, but they can't deal with rapid changes. Come on, just a couple of you hitting would be great! No, all of them failing. Although, did you just manage to get into space then? Were you actually that high up? This bomber does really confuse me. It spawned in a few times against us now, and every time I can't quite figure out what's wrong with it. Outdated craft, I suppose? Certainly looks like it. There's the bombs. Oh, missiles just missing there, and one only just clipping the side. So yeah, these missiles won't be a versus everything weapon. They are a versus very heavily armored enemies type of weapon. So, essentially, not this thing. All connected and firing in the background, so on this then, I would like two things. First of all, I would like the radar itself. There we go. The second thing I would like is a ballast tank. Now, the ballast tank, I believe that we can make it more buoyant. I believe that's how that works. Apply to all, there we go. And as you can see, they will now float on the top and give us radar information. Although, weirdly enough, they shouldn't have been firing at all, since I don't have any of the radars on my craft. There is actually a limit to how many of those you can fire, depending on how many radars you have attached. It's somewhere here. There we are, the missile radar and missile sonar holders. So I'll have to put those in, but that is actually that. Simple as that. It will keep on firing those as long as combat is going, and as long as I have enough of the radars attached to the craft. Every time they get destroyed, a new one will be fired, and thus we can see above the waterline. I then also need to add some sonars so that we can see underwater, and then I can add the torpedoes, and then I think I'm pretty much done. Although I am tempted to add yet another missile system as a backup to the main weapons. Maybe. Sonars and the radars are now completely functional, so this craft will be able to see pretty much everything within 3 kilometers of itself, which is pretty darn helpful. The last thing then will be the submarines, the torpedoes. Twice now I've done that. We need to fire submarines at the enemy, explosive suicide submarines. No, we are making torpedoes, and I think I'm going to build them along here, because right now, one thing I found out very quickly is that we do not need as many hydrofoils as we have currently attached. In fact, I've even lowered their angle down to 10, and they are still too powerful for this craft. We are nowhere near as big or as heavy as I first thought we were. So, I'm going to knock out this section of armor here, replace it a bit further back, and then turn this into a torpedo launcher section, which will only fire at enemies which are in the water as soon as I set up their control block. So, I'll be right back when that's done, and then I think it is done. Other than shields, but that's something I can do off camera because even for a building video, that is incredibly boring. Okay, the detection systems have now been reactivated, so if our ship can't see the enemy, it's not firing, and by the looks of things, it's just launched its new torpedoes. So, let's see how these do. These are pure explosive torpedoes with ballast tanks, so they should be very, very nasty. Oh, look at that! I think that was more showy than it was actual damage, though. I think they need to be a bit more separated. They seem to detonate each other rather than detonate on the enemy. Any more coming? Yep, here's the next volley. Once again, a bit too close to each other, but either way, a glorious explosion, which is going to make me very, very happy indeed. I think I need to set the ballast tanks to be a little bit lower as well. It would be doing far better if we were hitting the underside of the ship rather than the front of it. So, I'll make a few changes and we'll be right back for our second torpedo test. After these ones hit, because let's face it, we all love explosions. There we go. Yeah, definitely more showy than actually effective. Underneath would be a lot better. Test number two. This time the ballast tanks are keeping the missiles much lower. And by the looks of things, they are a lot more spread out as well. Oh, hitting the undercarriage, instantly causing a massive internal explosion. That is the difference between hitting the front and hitting the bottom of this craft. Also, apparently, it got the enemy so high up, it then caused us to fire the regular missiles. And so it is dead. I think our sub is going to be just fine. Okay, the missiles are now fixed, so they will fire at enemies which are simply low in the water. Beforehand, I had set it so they weren't tolerant enough to fire at enemies which were semi-submerged. But now they can. And so, lots of little explosions everywhere.
Taking control.
One-on-one versus the mortar, let's see who's going to win then. Ideally, the sub should just ultimately win. I'm actually surprised that the enemy can even see me underwater. Perhaps it has a sonar system which I wasn't aware of. We can see it because we have sonars and because we have these lovely little radars being thrown everywhere. Which will also act as great distractions for anti-missile systems. Let's just make sure that the torpedoes have been fired. Yes, they have, and by the looks of things, the enemy is about to die anyway. And torpedoes. Good to know. Our submarine is doing fantastically. So with that, I'm afraid I am all out of time for today's episode. I do apologise that this was a completely building video. It wasn't my intention. My first plan was to get half of it done in the first half, so we have the submarine basically functional, then the second half go back over to the campaign and finish it there, but time kind of got away from me, and now it's been like 4 or 5 hours, so I will try to push the next episode out a little bit sooner than originally intended to make up for this, but I really do hope you've enjoyed. Some of you seem to love building videos, and I appreciate you so, so much in a game which is 90%+ building. So thank you so much for watching. If you have enjoyed the video, then of course, likes, favourites, shares, comments, all that good stuff helps out me, helps out the channel, and most importantly, shows that From the Depths is a series you wish to see continued in the future. In the next episode, we're going back into the campaign, and our submarines will be used to capture some new territory, and then we can build variants of them with different types of missiles, perhaps some using advanced cannons, some using purely torpedoes, a lot of specialist stuff, maybe even lasers. But for now, we have the base model, and the base model seems to be doing just fine. Thank you for watching, and goodbye.